Hello and welcome to a new video on cryptography for everybody. Today we will create transcriptions of ciphers. I was asked by a viewer of this channel if I could make a video especially about transcribing ciphers. And yeah, this is a video on how you can create transcriptions of ciphers or how we create transcriptions of ciphers. I structured today's video into four different parts. In the first part, we will discuss why do we need digital transcriptions of ciphertexts. After that, I will present the ABC method, a naive approach for creating transcriptions. Then I want to in detail discuss the transcription guidelines of the DECRYPT project. The DECRYPT project is a research project I'm currently working in. And finally, we will have a look at our transcription tools that we have implemented in CrypTool 2. Why do we need digital transcriptions? Historically, ciphertexts are written usually with ink on paper. And you can see an example for a historical ciphertext here on the right side. This is a photo of the Codex Copiale, an 18th century encrypted book. And you can find this picture on Wikipedia. And usually when we get such ciphertexts, we only have photos or scans of these ciphertexts. And if you want to solve or break such a text by hand, you usually do not need a digital transcription. But if you want to perform analysis using a computer, for instance, you need a digital transcription. Why do we need digital transcriptions? First of all, the algorithms, for instance, for counting letters and for solving ciphers, are not able to work on pixel data. So you cannot put in a picture into this algorithm and then it reads pixel per pixel and analyzes this ciphertext. This is something we would like to have, but right now our algorithms work on text data. And text data means, for instance, text files encoded, for instance, as ASCII or UTF-8. And also, if you want to exchange the ciphertext with others, for instance, other researchers, a transcription is also helpful, since these would also work on text data instead of working on the pictures. Clearly, these pictures are still important because when we create transcriptions, of course, we make errors. And to fix an error, you have to go back to the picture and have a look, for instance, at this, let's say, sentence here, and then you see, okay, the third symbol that we transcribed is wrong. In the picture, it is some kind of U, and we transcribed some kind of X, I don't know. And there are other reasons why we need transcriptions. For instance, transcriptions help us to see if we understand the ciphertext and its structure. That means, for instance, what are single letters or symbols of the cipher. Sometimes this is not very clear, and when we create a transcription, we have something to discuss with others. Or we could, for instance, see if we miss something. For instance, a dot on top, you can see here on this small c, there's a dot on the top, and sometimes, or someone could miss that dot, and then the meaning is a different meaning than a c with a dot on top. And having a transcription tells us how the other one that we are discussing with understood this ciphertext. Then, did we spot all spaces between words? I can give the transcription to another person and then he or she can test or see if I miss, for instance, spaces. And spaces are really helpful for cryptanalysis. And finally, we can see that did we merge ciphertexts or if we merged ciphertext symbols. That means, for instance, here we have some ink on the paper, or we have ciphertext symbols that are very close. For instance, this here is a good example. I don't know yet, is this a single symbol or are these two symbols? With this Copiale cipher, since it's very beautifully and well written, it's quite easy, but with other ciphertexts this can be difficult, and sometimes we merge symbols, and we will see this in our transcription. And we can also see if someone else is able, using our transcription, to find the same solution we found. So, for instance, we deciphered this text and we want to test, is this decipherment correct? Then we give our transcription to another person, and the other person then is able to also perform cryptanalysis, and when he or she finds the same plain text, we know our decipherment is correct. Clearly, we could also perform the step of creating a transcription in parallel, and then we could compare our transcriptions if we came to the same conclusion and to the same ciphertext symbol transcriptions, for instance. Now let's move on to the ABC method, which is our naive approach. And I named this method the ABC method for a reason. I don't think this is the official name. I don't even know if there is an official name, but I think ABC method is a quite good name. And it's a naive method to transcribe a ciphertext consisting of arbitrary symbols. And the method goes as follows. First, take the ciphertext and an empty piece of paper, for instance, you could use Windows Notepad or any other digital editor, then you can transcribe it directly onto your computer. And for the first ciphertext symbol, use A as transcription. Then for the second ciphertext symbol, use B. For the third, use C, etc. Then you transcribe the ciphertext, for instance, as A, B, C, and so on. And here the A means the first letter is different from the B, the C is different from the B, but then we have the first letter again. And we go on and on and on and use all the letters of the alphabet, for instance, uppercase. When we use 26 letters and we need more, we could use lowercase letters, then we can go to digits and then to special symbols. And I have also a tip. Create a table where you note down your assignments so you don't forget these. For instance, when we go back to the Cryptanalysis cipher, if you would use the method with the Cryptanalysis cipher, then this would be an A, this would be a B, this would be a C. And I would use a piece of paper, copy the original ciphertext symbols onto that paper, and then besides that symbols, I would create or add the transcribed symbols, for instance, the A, B, and C. So in fact, you would create the key. It's not really the key since it's still encrypted. So as you can see here, we still get some kind of ciphertext, but it's a transcription that we can then use for cryptanalysis, for instance, with CrypTool 2. The advantages of this method is it's a very easy method that works with every cipher. And it can be done using only a piece of paper. The disadvantages are clearly we have no one-by-one transcription, so we do not get the meaning of the symbols. And we have no standardized transcription then. That means that same ciphertext symbols that appear in different ciphertexts are transcribed differently. So let's assume we transcribe the Cryptanalysis cipher and we have this dash here and this O and this G, and we use the ABC method and this is A, B, and C. Another cipher, now let's assume this here is a different cipher, the right page. Now the A would be this symbol, the B this symbol, and the C this symbol. This makes it impossible to compare different ciphertexts. And maybe we have also ciphertexts that use the same key, so it's good to transcribe these in the same way. And that's what I meant here. The symbols are not transcribed using themselves. Now let's move forward to the DECRYPT transcription guidelines. And the DECRYPT transcription guidelines were developed by two colleagues from the DECRYPT project. And the guidelines allow standardized transcriptions of historical ciphers and keys. You can see here the DECRYPT transcription guidelines, and I will also link the document below the video. You can get the DECRYPT transcription guidelines from the DECRYPT webpage, from the webpage of the DECRYPT research project. And I highly suggest when you want to create standardized transcriptions, then use these guidelines. These are really, really well made. And here I copied a citation from the introduction, which I think very well describes why we should do or why we should use these transcription guidelines. There are many different ways of transcribing a manuscript. For instance, as I have shown you the ABC method. Therefore, we developed guidelines so that the transcriptions of ciphers can follow the same standard and format to be able to carry out comparative studies across ciphers. And I think this is very important, that all transcriptions are standardized, that we can compare these, that we can create comparative studies. All transcriptions done in the DECRYPT project and stored in our decode database, this is our storage for historical encrypted manuscripts, are based on these guidelines. So all the transcriptions are standardized. And I think this is really a great thing, and this is really important for our research project. And the nice thing, as I already said, with the guidelines is that the guidelines are freely available, and you can download these from the Decrypt webpage. You have it here, www.d-crypt.org/publications.php. Here you will find the transcription guidelines in the current version. And I think they are still get updates. If we find out that maybe something is not as good as we would like, or we want to change something, then of course we update the guidelines based on the findings in the Decrypt project. Now I have to say that this video only covers transcriptions of ciphertexts and not of keys. As you have seen, the guidelines also describe how to transcribe cryptographic keys, but this is not part of this video. We will have a look at how to transcribe ciphertexts using the guidelines. And from now on, we use cipher as synonym for ciphertext. And this has been done in the transcription guidelines because computer linguists use it differently from cryptography, where the cipher is a method and the ciphertext is the result. But in this document, when we speak of cipher, we actually mean an encrypted ciphertext. And the transcription guidelines define two different parts to be transcribed. First, they define how to transcribe metadata of a cipher, which is very important. And then they describe how to transcribe the actual content of a cipher. So what do we mean with metadata? Metadata are as follows. Each transcript file of a particular cipher, which may consist of multiple images, starts with comment lines indicated by this hash symbol with information about the file. So when you create a transcription, everything that has a hash is a comment. And then we describe the metadata, for instance, like here. We have a hash, this is a ciphertext. Then we have, for instance, a catalog name. This is our own index, for instance, for the location in our decode database. Then we have a name for the image. Then we have metadata who transcribed that ciphertext. I think this is also important. If you want to ask the transcriber questions, then you see, okay, this document has been transcribed, for instance, by this Tim B here. Then we have a date of transcription, which is also important. That is when the transcription has been created. Then we have a transcription time. So how many time took it to transcribe all the image of a cipher? This is also important for a research project to find out how long it takes people to transcribe, for instance, ciphers. And then we have, for instance, metadata of the transcription method. So for instance, did you use speech recognition or did you do it by hand and so on and so forth. Now, in the transcribed document, we use tags like note AU or note ED you can say notes. We have AU, these are authorial notes, AU namely notes that are part of the original manuscript and which were written by the author of the document. That means when you transcribe a cipher and there are clear text written notes on that ciphertext, could be that someone wrote something on the document, then you indicate this with this text here, then you write note, then you write AU for authorial notes, and then you can write down what you can read on the ciphertext. But we have also editorial notes, which are part of the document itself, which are not part of the document itself, but which are left by the transcriber and are used in order to provide further explanations about the content of the document. For instance, when you have problems transcribing something or you understand a symbol in a different way. For instance, you think that these symbols belong together, but you're not sure, you could write editorial notes when you perform transcriptions. And now we come to how to transcribe the content of a cipher. And our guidelines state that each new image in a cipher starts with a new comment line with information about the name of the image, followed by a possible note from the transcriber. For instance, we have here the ID in the text document of the transcription, then database ID, for instance, followed by underscore, followed automated generated image ID, that's how we do it. Then we have optional identification information from the archive, so you can write surface, and then you could write, for instance, where you found it in an archive when you transcribe the cipher. And then you could use these node ED, for instance, for the editorial nodes at the beginning, and you can write any comments, for instance, difficult here with this transcription, it was difficult to read line 3, we have bleed through ink on that page, and so on and so forth, so that someone who uses your transcription is aware of the problems you had creating that transcription. Now let's speak about the transcription of the actual content. And the rules are quite easy. First of all, the transcription is carried out symbol by symbol and row by row, so as you read. And each symbol is transcribed separately, meaning that we add a space after each symbol. So you can see this here. We have one here, a digit cipher, 13017 and so on. And we write 13017, but we put a space between these symbols. This makes it easier for the cryptanalysis to distinguish between the symbols. Now we know the 1 is a single symbol, the 3 is a single symbol, the 0 is a single symbol. We will later see that there can be symbols that are transcribed using more than one letter. Also, the line breaks are kept. So when you have here a line break and then you have the next digits on the next line, we make the line break here. If the line break would be here, we would also put the line break here. And now we have a problem since we use the space for separating the symbols here, the ciphertext symbols, we have now to also transcribe spaces since these are very important for cryptanalysis. And to transcribe a space between words, we use a tag. Like space here. We have opening bracket, then space, closing bracket, and a tag space. Now, how do we handle punctuation marks? Punctuation marks are transcribed as they appear. So when you see a dot or a comma, you also transcribe these, since these could be very important. Now, we have seen on the previous page how we transcribe, for instance, digit ciphers. These are quite easy to transcribe, since we only have digits from 0 to 9, maybe with dot on the top or so. But many of the original historic ciphers use different alphabets, for instance, Greek alphabet, Roman numerals, and so on. And we use for symbols then other alphabets as Greek or Roman numerals. You can use Unicode representations, and these are listed in the appendix section A1 and A2 of the guidelines. So when you take our transcription guideline document, you can find the set of symbols you can use for the transcription. Also, special symbols such as zodiac or alchemical signs can be found in the guidelines. For instance, first look at the zodiac signs appendix 3 or at the alchemical signs appendix 4, and then we have also a category other signs A5. And here we have some example transcriptions of ciphers consisting of such symbols. For instance, we have here a transcription using the Unicode name. So we have here a transcribed R. Then we have the Gemini symbol, we have conjunction symbol, Taurus symbol, conjunction symbol, and so on. Then we have here another type of transcription that you can create automatically using the names here. We have here the R, then we have a space, then we have 264A, 260C. These are hex values of the Unicode symbols. And using these transcriptions here, we can finally create a transcription using the original symbols. For instance, we have here R, then the space, and now we have the original symbols as they appear in the ciphertext. Now there's a speciality with historic ciphers, and that is the usage of dots on top or below and other special kind of symbols. For instance, we could have with digit ciphers a digit with a dot on the top. And I remember a case where someone transcribed a digit cipher and omitted all the dots on the top and the bottom, and we couldn't analyze the cipher correctly or couldn't break it since important information, the dots on the top were missing, since these change the meaning of the 3. So a 3 is a different ciphertext symbol that is than a 3 with a dot on the top. And how do we transcribe these? We write the 3, then we write this to the top here, and then we write a dot. That means a dot on the top. When we want to have an accent on the top, we could write this with a comma here. If we want to have a dot on bottom, we could write 3, then lower dash, and then a dot. And when we want to write a dot on top and on bottom, we would use brackets like here. We have bracket, then dot on the top. You could also write something, for instance, if you have a 3 with a, b on top, you could write this with an a and b. And here, a dot below, we would write in this way. Now we have some other special kind of symbols. For instance, we have a 0 with a dash through the middle, and we transcribe this with a 0 and a plus. Here we have a 2 with a plus, and we write 2 plus. Here we have a 4 with a plus, and so on. And as you can see here, no spaces between the digit and the plus, meaning this here is a single symbol. When we go back here, you see that this Gemini here is also a single symbol. The ciphertext symbols are separated using spaces, and the spaces in our transcription are created using the space symbol. And in fact, the space symbol is is handled like any other symbol in the ciphertext. So for the analysis, the first thing I would do then, I would mark this is a space, that the space word or the space, the symbol transcribed with the word space or the text space is a space symbol. And then the analyzer knows this is the space symbol. Now let's discuss how we handle clear text. And clear text is text which appears in the cipher, but we indicate this with the clear text text. And clear text is non-encrypted text appearing on the encrypted document. For example, here we have this digit cipher here, and then in the middle we have come la mis comada, here we have it, come la mi coma. This is old Italian, I think. And to indicate that this here is clear text, we write a clear text tag, and then we write the clear text and we close the tag. And this could, for instance, then later be used in the cipher, in the analysis, in the automated analysis, to remove all these clear text tags, since our analyzers would be confused by these. But we still can gain information for the analysis out of it by having a look at the clear text. So we also transcribe clear text. And as I said, we do this using these tags here. Now we know two different ways how to describe ciphertext. The first one is the ABC method, and the second one are the decrypt transcription guidelines. In CrypTool 2, we have a quite old component, I have to say, which is the transcriptor component. And this allows us to perform the ABC method. And this is what I want to present you now. I'm here now in CrypTool 2, and I want to show you the transcriptor component in CrypTool 2. And to find the transcriptor component, we just write transcriptor. And we have two different templates. We have a manual mode template and a semi-automatic mode. And I first show you the manual mode. And when you save these templates here, the transcription is also saved, usually. Not with the manual mode. With the manual mode, I think you have to perform this by yourself. I have to have a look. So when we want to transcribe here, for instance, here I loaded a ciphertext made of winding symbols. And now we could say, okay, this here is a new symbol. And then it assigns the A here to this symbol. Then we go to the next symbol, drag the mouse over it, and we say new symbol. And then we go on and forth, new symbol, and new symbol. And this is very tedious, since you have to go through all of these symbols here. You can also make a full size view. And now there's an interesting part here. We have add space. And now let's have a look at a symbol we already transcribed. So we make a box around this here. And then CrypTool 2, or the component, the transcriptor, tries to guess which symbol this is. And since, of course, the rectangle about the original B symbol here is not as accurate as this now, or not the same, we do not get a 100%, but it tells us that the marked symbol here is by 54% or nearly 55% equal to the B symbol here. And when we double click here, we transcribe it using the same symbol. Now we can also delete this by just right, I think it was right clicking. Ah, no, I found it out. It is control and then you click, for instance, on the box and then it removes the box. One thing you have to do when you transcribe such a text using CrypTool 2, you have to go from left to right and from top to bottom. Now we say again, add space. And when we go to, let's assume we transcribed here some lines, then you can click on a symbol and I think, since this is transcribed the symbol by symbol from left to right, from top to bottom, we don't need first symbol here. I think that we need the first symbol here in the full automatic mode. And that is what I want to show you next. So you can use the transcriptor to transcribe it manually, but you can also use a semi-automatic mode. Let's see. And in this template, it has been already transcribed. So I can first show you the result. If you transcribed your text here completely, and then you click the generate button, you get the transcription here. And here is also the important thing. When you click on first symbol on, you can mark symbols, and then the transcriptor knows that this is the first symbol of a row. So that means that row now would go on here, but we have this here as first symbols. So this is a hint for the transcriptor where the rows start. And to get the ciphertext, you always click generate. Now I want to show you the semi-automatic mode. So we have to stop this template here. We change the mode here to semi-automatic. I think 85 is okay. Press play. And now I removed all the symbols. And when we now transcribe symbols here, and we say new symbol, with this ciphertext, this works quite good. It automatically transcribes or marks the same symbol that we have here transcribed or marked as a symbol. Now we go to that skull symbol. Say new symbol, and it also marks all the skulls. The problem with the transcriptor is this is an educational tool. You can use it for printed ciphers like this one, because the ciphertext symbols are quite similar, and this works very well. When you want to transcribe original historical ciphers, I suggest that you use the DECRYPT transcription guidelines, and you do this by hand using a notepad, for instance. Or you use some of the tools that we develop or are currently developing in the DECRYPT project. So stay tuned for the DECRYPT project and the results, since we are working on automated transcription also in the DECRYPT project. If you're interested in that, have a look at our webpage and the papers of our colleagues. Now, for instance, let's transcribe the next symbol here. And it should mark... No, it didn't. But as you can also see, we have, for instance, here this flag, and I spotted here another flag symbol, and this was not automatically marked, but you can still make a box out of it and then double click here, and you can go on like this. With the semi-automatic mode, you can transcribe as you want to. That means you don't need to transcribe from left to right, from top to bottom. As you can see here, these symbols are also marked, but we are still in the first line. And that's why we need the first symbol method here. So when you click this, you can say, okay, this line starts here, this line starts here. Of course, we would start here, this line here, here, and so on and so forth. And when you click it again, you deactivate this symbol as the first symbol in that line. And here, so and so forth. And after some time, for instance, like with this template here, you can transcribe a ciphertext using the transcriptor. And in fact, I created this transcription or this template many years ago when we implemented the transcriptor. This was actually implemented in a bachelor project when I was at the University of Kassel, and I wanted to have a nice tool to present or to show people how to transcribe ciphers. And as I said, it's helpful with these printed ciphertexts. When you want to go for original historical ciphertexts, I suggest that you do it by hand. But you could also use the DECRYPT transcription guidelines, or if you don't want to have this huge set of rules and you have a very small cipher, for instance, like a postcard, encrypted postcard, you could use the ABC method. Yeah, and this is everything I wanted to present in this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If yes, please give a thumbs up. And also, if you did not yet subscribe to this channel, I would be really happy if you do so. This really helps us to grow the channel and to make CrypTool 2 more popular. If you have any questions, please write below this video. I will try and answer all of your questions. And if you need help, for instance, with a cipher or the analysis of a cipher, you could also write below this video or write an email to me. Yeah, and this is everything. So thank you very much for watching and see you in the next video.